Oh, good lord, finally. But yeah, I mean, overall, this game really isn't good. It's kind of tedious. I mean, I feel bad for a lot of the people who like did really good like art or design or like the people who helped write the story, but like putting them together, it was like they had a Star Wars game with all the outlaying and then they like just threw in a bunch of other stuff. Like I honestly I spent most of the game organizing my inventory and going up elevators than I spent in actual gameplay. Or in like annoying, unskippable cutscenes or talking. I mean, overall, it isn't. It certainly isn't worth the accolades it gets. I'm gonna have to say. Like, so many people love Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic, but honestly, Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic was the most buggy, glitchy, garbage game. And if you hadn't stamped Star Wars on it, no one would have bought it at all. And I don't know where, like out of nowhere, people were suddenly like, "BioWare is so amazing, they do no wrong." No, they do a lot of wrong. People say the same thing, like, "Oh, like you're just a Fallout fan or whatever. Of course you don't like it. You know, PS3 or PC fan, of course you wouldn't like it because Mass Effect is an Xbox 360, you know, RPG." Well, no. Bethesda made a lot of bad games, and they fixed a lot of the problems in over the course of their history. You know, they, like, yeah, there's a lot of bugs in some of their other games, but they offer a bigger variety than this game does. And they actually offer choices that are choices. Instead of, like, you know, do you want to save the universe, or do you want to destroy the universe? And then they give you an option, like, yes, no. And then you're like, yes. And it's like, okay, you're going to save the universe. And then you're like, no. Well, I want to destroy it, but I'm still going to save the universe. That's not really a choice. That just becomes inane, really. And, like, I understand doing, like, certain verbal checks, like you do in, like, D&D or other role-playing games, where you do, like, a check on for your charisma or whatever. But really, in reality, those kind of, like, charisma check things are kind of important, but it would tell you like a minimum, like, oh, to do this, you would need X amount of this. Like, those just felt like an afterthought. Like, they said, well, we should have a few extra dialogue options. Like, in whole, I probably could have got through the game without even adding them. The only reason I really wanted to add them is, well, one, I wanted to save Rex, because he's probably the only reasonable character in the game. I mean, really. But, like, it's not just you get the skill, you have to be of that skill. So it's like, oh yeah, I had a lot of Intimidate, but I didn't have enough Renegade points, so it doesn't matter. But that's not like a true skill check. That's like rolling a dice, but you can only get a certain dice to roll for the check. That's stupid. Like, it basically makes Charm pointless, because if you have really high Paragon, you could just have Charm 1, essentially. And it would override even later versions of Charm. Because Charm really didn't do anything, you just had to get it to the end to get what you needed. But you still needed Paragon points. It's really backwards. It's like you need to max out two skills to get one skill that's not very useful. Very stupid. And like, who's gonna spend the time to get all of their characters to max level? That's just kinda silly. And like, the inventory in this game, like, good lord, the inventory in this game made me furious. Like, ultimately, every game should have an overall items, and then you have filters to sort it by, like, you know, assault rifles, pistols, items, usable items, whatever. Find some system to make it work. But this one avoided it. It didn't let you look at your whole inventory. You'd have to go into submenu to submenu to submenu. So it worked the opposite of the filter idea that every game has ever done, because it's a reasonable system. You know, I don't understand why they did this, but I mean, it's beyond me why anyone would be okay with that. I thought it was just really frustrating. And, you know, really, like, at a certain point, you should either have, like, a stack option or a store option. Just to get, like, you know, there was one time I went into my items to sell them, and first of all, the way they arranged them in the sell menu, I don't know if you saw earlier, but But basically, it's like you have Cryo Rounds 4, Cryo Round 6, Cryo Round 7, whatever. But you have to, like, scroll up and down the menu back and forth to see what's better, because they don't just put, like, everything in a category, in one category. They did, like, Cryo Rounds 5, then it's, like, other things in between, then it gets down to Cryo Round 6, and then there's, like, you know, weapons and armor and everything in the way of the Cryo Round 7. And it's completely asinine, so I'd have to scroll down to the bottom and see which advanced ones I have, and then go back and delete whichever non-advanced ones I have. Ultimately, me selling the shotguns and the sniper rifles was the best thing I could have ever done in this game, because, frankly, using them off-screen, they don't do anything. Like, they're completely worthless. The shotgun is only up close, the sniper rifle is only far away, and both of them don't fire enough shots to make a dick of a difference when I can fire at a pretty good range. Really, realistically, I fire way farther than the shotgun, about on par with the assault rifle with the pistol, and I can kill most things pretty quickly. I mean, shields are like one of those things like, oh yeah, you've seen it and you've shot it a couple times. And ultimately, the game decided that, you know, oh, well, let's throw in these shotguns and sniper rifles, but there's no point. They're absolutely useless items. Like, if your gun always overheats and does about... Actually, most of the shotguns do about the same damage as pistols, high-end pistols. So what would be the point of having that? That makes no sense. Like, I don't think they really thought it through. They just thought, oh, some people will like to snipe. But most of the enemies can snipe you with their pistols, or their machine guns anyway. Like, oh, you might get a little extra range. Well, I had enemies that were hitting me before I could even see them. Like... So it really made sniper rifles ultimately pointless. And even the zoom on the sniper rifle wasn't that great. It wasn't like some amazing, like, I could see halfway across a goddamn planet with this. No, it was really subpar. So getting rid of them was the best thing I ever did, because it saved the space in between what I'd have to do. And I could just sell all of the older pistols. The other thing is that the upgrades for their weapons, they felt really dry and generic. And they also really evaded explaining the difference between damage protection, hardening, physics, and shields. They really didn't separate them on how they break down into combat. If it was like, shields are your base defense, but the defense of your shields go up if you get hardening, or the hardening prevents your defense after your shields drop, and damage protection doesn't protect your shields, or just protect you, because... That would mean most of the things are like, oh, 9%, an extra 9%, but when you don't have that much hardening, if hardening is in fact your actual defense, then it would make more sense to get something like plus 20 hardening, or plus 20% hardening, than it would to get damage prevention. They didn't really understand or really break down how this would work in any sort of feasible fashion. The other thing is that the amps and all that stuff really were useless. I mean, if you look at them, everything healed for about the same. It depended on my skill. Again, it's just like the verbal checks. You're doing two things to do the same thing. Like, the only difference is it added a little bit of shield and really did not help your cooldown bonus that much. Honestly, putting points into medicine and other skills that decrease the time for cooldown was much more effective than getting the little tech amp things, the little hand computer. So ultimately, they really became pointless. And when I was searching off screen on planets and stuff, the Mako became less powerful than my regular characters were, which is to say that you have this ultimate vehicle that can't be upgraded, in quote, ultimate vehicle that can't be upgraded. The enemies get stronger, but you can do more damage than that can. Like, I really think it would have been better, especially in the later parts of the game, if you at least could spend like a million credits, because, I mean, frankly, with all the cryo rounds you were selling or whatever garbage weapons you had, you were constantly getting, you know, a million credits or whatever. It wouldn't be bad to say, oh, you have to pay a million to get an upgraded Mako or something at least half decent. And, yeah, I mean, that's just asinine, really. I mean, the only thing is it moves faster, and you can't get teammates lost. The other thing I have to say is, like, the damage checks and balancing is kind of annoying. I kind of wish they had at least put like a percentage flag or something that might tell you your percentage of hitting or something. I mean, I don't want it to be Dungeons and Dragons where like 2% of your attacks hit, but it was just kind of frustrating. The other thing I have to complain about is the use of celebrity voices. If you use celebrity voices in a game, you ask them to mask them. Or, I understand using a celebrity voice if they were that character. I know earlier I said Guinan, but I meant Deanna Troi, and I've already mentioned this. Use of Deanna Troi's voice. Deanna Troi has a very specific voice, and making her talk exactly like she did in Star Trek doesn't help. It just sounds like you're, like she's, you know, Deanna Troi, but for Saren. And using Bishop as a commander, kind of barking orders the way he does, he just sound, I forget his name in real life, but, you know, he's the guy from Pumpkinhead and Alien and a whole bunch of other movies. But it's just ridiculous to have this guy who has a very notable voice as this commander. I just don't think it works. And the other guy, I forget his name, the guy who played Anderson, I've seen him in a lot of stuff, and I always forget his name, but he's a great actor, and his voice is very recognizable as well, so that's a really bad move. And Seth Green as the pilot is just like a cue-in. That's like, who do the kids like these days? I heard Seth Green is popular. Let's get him down here. Like, most of his dialogue felt like it was forced to say that stuff. Like, he is the pilot of the ship. The pilot. You would have a communications officer for communications and to file reports. This guy is flying an interstellar starship. Why is he writing reports for you? Is he like your own private secretary? Or is this just like something they felt like doing? Like, oh, the pilot has to press a button to do mundane transactions. No, it just felt like a device to get Seth Green actually as some sort of relevant character in this game. Frankly, Joker was the least interesting character. I would have preferred if I could get any pilot, or like have one of the people I picked up along the way be the pilot. And like, the other thing is that some of the character interactions and dialogue, despite their actions not going anywhere, looping conversation is annoying. It's better just to say like, oh, well, I've already talked about anything, or like a refresher that's a little bit different, or like they say it once more and that's it. But like, there were times where if you kept clicking, you could just go keep going in an infinite loop of conversation of the same conversation. Like, oh, where's Saren? Oh, Saren's by the Moo Relay. Oh, well, where's Saren? Oh, he's by the Moo Relay. Oh, where's the Moo Relay? You know, it would just keep looping, and that's just stupid. Also, despite the little key hints they tell you, Spacebar does not always skip dialogue to the next thing. It doesn't. I learned that very early in the game that you can't do that. And I know I got enraged, and the rest of the game became kind of a joke after that opening of annoyance. But the character interactions and any bond that I feel towards a character is not that interesting. You need to make characters talk a little more or say something a little more motivated. Rex was the only character that would add like half-decent things. Ashley would be whining or saying something about God or morality or something obnoxious along the path. And I hate that. I don't want someone to tell me exactly what I should do, and especially not be so judgmental about it. That's always annoying in games. You know, most of these like, you know, characters they throw in really just look like cut-out Star Wars characters. Frankly, Liara, being blue and looking the way she does, she looks like a Twi'lek. Let's just get that out there. She looks like a Twi'lek. She just doesn't, or Twi'lek, whatever. She just doesn't have the two blue horns. Instead, she kind of has wavy little tentacles in her hair. Other than the things about species that I'm not even going to get into, and how preposterous some of the theses in the game are, like, most of this was fairly ridiculous in a way. But the embassies, only having, like, really three major embassies is kind of ridiculous. And just to add on top of that, you have other alien races who don't get a seat on the council, and then we expect a seat, and then there are these other races that we haven't heard of, and all this other stuff. Like, I feel like they didn't even think the council out, and they didn't make it like... Like, basically, it was like the Star Wars Senate. There were supposed to be lots of alien races looking for a way to speak and be on the head council or whatever. But it just came out that they were a bunch of dicks, really. A bunch of, like, oh no, we're done with the Krogan. Let's just sterilize them and set them out to pasture. You know, it's kind of insane. You think that people would be like, okay, well, we'll help the Krogan then. Screw you guys. But I don't know. It felt contrived. And the whole world is based around this idea that, like, very human concepts, which isn't very smart to do. You don't base things around human concepts if it has to do with alien worlds. That's just ridiculous. And of course, I mean, I understand language barrier, which is always whatever. But it just didn't feel like it was a world. You know, you didn't go to any major colonies. You went to, like, one major city. The other one was a dump. So it felt like it was... like you're in a gigantic dead universe, and the only people live on the Citadel. Like, you can't even land on Earth, even if it was, like, go see a military base or something. But, anyway, the other thing, and pretty much the last thing I'm going to say about Mass Effect is that there's a game called Starflight. I believe it was Starflight that came out, where you could travel around to little worlds and survey them and do all this stuff. One part of Mass Effect felt like that part of the game, but dumbed down heavily. Then the other part of this obviously felt like a Star Wars game. All the dialogue, all like the characters and worlds and interactions all felt like one of the Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic games, which is obviously because it's BioWare. Then the other part of the game, which is the combat, felt like a really generic game. It's like they needed something to throw in there. And I think it's great and all. But, you know, Fallout did a really good system with that. There's Borderlands even had a good system for that. Honestly, it didn't really matter what I plugged into my gun. I was still killing Geth just as fast as I was killing humans. But that aside, this game felt like it was pieced together, and that people weren't working in unison to create a good game. And the tone through the game would vastly shift so much that it didn't feel urgent. It felt like you were doing something else. It's like, well, I went to the grocery store, but instead I decided to go next door and get my hair cut. And, you know, I was going to go in and get the groceries, but then I saw there's a comic book shop across the street, so I went over there. It's like you went around the block where the grocery store was, but you, like, not until the last, like, you know, half an hour of the game did you actually go into the grocery store and get what you need. So, I mean, there was just basically there's too much run around, and it wasn't working together. And the music at the end was like a where the frick did this come from? Also, it's one thing to have NPCs, but to have NPCs that you can't talk to or aren't like, go away, I'm not talking to you, or I'm on duty, or like, I hate you, human. You know, it really makes it kind of boring, frankly. And the back and forth mission dialogues were mildly entertaining. All in all, I mean, if I had to really give this game a rating, it would be okay. It wouldn't be good. It wouldn't be bad. It's just... it's the same thing as Sonic the Hedgehog or, like, Super Mario Brothers. It's a good game, but it would get boring and stale really quickly. But that's my opinion of this. You can take your own. If you want to go play it, go ahead and play it. Do whatever you want. I'm actually going to start playing the second one now, to see how that goes, and hopefully there's save transfer or something so I can actually feel like I'm playing, you know, a continuation of the story. Although, apparently they've already started a Mass Effect 3, so... yay. Well, anyway, that's all for Let's Play Mass Effect with me, Morak Dias. See you later. Ah, actually not see you later. I forgot I have to go back into the menu to get my mouse back. This game randomly kidnaps your mouse too, which is kind of annoying. Okay. We'll leave on this lovely picture of Rex. See you later.